Bam, it's true. In this video, we're going to define and do a couple of examples involving the Rolle's theorem. Hopefully I'm saying that man's name right. It's basically like a special case of the mean value theorem, and it says, let f be continuous on a closed interval of ab and differentiable on the open interval of ab. If f of a equals f of b, then there is at least one number c in this interval from a to b, this open interval a to b, where f prime of c is equal to 0. Now, so I've drawn a little sort of a bottom end of a parabola here, or just, you know, some function with a minimum value, and I've got it marked off where, well, let's call this function g, and g of a is equal to g of b. I'm trying to draw this, these points, of course, are horizontal from each other. And through these two points, it doesn't specifically say secant line in this theorem, but, you know, if f of a, g of a is equal to g of b, then if you were to draw a secant line through those two points, it would be horizontal and thus have a slope of 0. And first derivatives, of course, again, tell us the slope of a curve function, or any function for that matter. So it just says that somewhere within this interval from a to b is, you know, if g of a and g of b are equal, then there's a value c, an x-coordinate of c, such that when you plug that value of c into the first derivative, you get a slope that is equal to 0, or you get a horizontal tangent line at that point of g of c. So let's see this in practice. Oh, almost forgot. We're going to do two examples, but I want to discuss why we need to have this statement within the theorem, that it's differentiable. Well, that is because, and there might be some other instances of this, but think of absolute value functions. Absolute value functions, they don't have to form like, you know, two linear patterns and form in a V, but they do have a sharp bend in them. So if I say here's function F, and I am going to make mine just a straight V, we have a couple of points at A and B where F of A is equal to F of B, so we have that horizontal secant line. Our function, whether it goes up or down, you know, does change value. I got mine going down, and I'm going to have a minimum like I do in this function, but there's a sharp bend. Well, maybe the slope is negative 1/2 and the slope is positive 1/2, or the slope is negative 1 and positive 1, but somewhere at, you know, let's just mark this off as c again, at our minimum value, we have a sharp bend. Well, you can't find the derivative at a sharp bend, and so thus with this example, even though f of a is equal to f of b, there is going to be no derivative value. There's going to be no place where you can plug in the value of c into the derivative and get a slope of 0, and that is because of the sharp bend, and we cannot find the derivative, or this function is not differentiable at the value of c. So we do need that smooth, continuous curve, not a continuous curve with sharp bends, because again, cannot find the first derivatives, or any derivative for that matter, at those points. Let's look at those examples. One's going to be algebraic, and one's going to involve trig functions. Woo! So here's our example. We have find the x-intercepts, which means that we're going to find two x-values where the y-value is equal to 0, so there's your horizontal secant line, and show that there is a value of c within that interval that we find in the first step where we find the x-intercepts that contains, or where the f prime of c, where the derivative, the first derivative, is equal to 0. And we have f of x is equal to x times the square root of x plus 9. So, let's find some x-intercepts. Now, for x-intercepts, of course, you need your y-value to equal 0. That's what happens when you cross the x-axis. So, 0 equals x times the square root of x plus 9. Now, this is basically in factored form. It doesn't really look like it, how we would normally expect to see it in algebra, or algebra 2, or precalculus for that matter, but we do have one factor here, x, being multiplied to a second factor of the square root of x plus 9. Don't forget that square root functions, or any math function like a fraction bar or an absolute value symbol, they act as a grouping symbol. So it's one thing here with the first x, this first factor, times this second something, which just happens to be a little bit more complicated than we normally see. Now, since it's sort of already in factored form, and there's more than one way to get this kind of solution, I want to just write this as, well, either the first factor needs to be equal to 0, or the second factor, which is the square root of x plus 9, has to be equal to 0. If either one of those factors equals 0, then the entire equation is equal to 0. Well, this answer is already done. My first x-intercept is 0. Over here, we have the square root of x plus 9 equals 0. And, you know, I'm hesitating because I'm sure some of you, you know, can get this answer in your head, but in case the question's a bit more complicated, I want to remind you, of course, that we do get rid of those square roots by square rooting both sides of the equation. We get x plus 9 equals 0, and therefore when you subtract both sides by 9, you get x equals negative 9. So, f of 0 equals 0, and f of negative 9 equals 0. So somewhere within that interval, the Rolle's theorem says that the first derivative, there will be some value of c, some x value between negative 9 and 0, some c value between negative 9 and 0. There's some value that when you plug it into the first derivative, you'll get an answer of 0. So let's find that first derivative and see if it's true, or that we've worked our problem out correctly, because I don't need to prove Rolle's theorem. It's already been done. F of x is equal to x times x plus 9 to the 1/2 power. I don't want to do derivatives with radical symbols. This is the product property. So when is that function, when is this first derivative going to equal 0? Well, this first derivative is a rational function, and when your rational function, when you have a fraction, if fraction equals 0 and the numerator is equal to 0. So I'm going to carry this up. I'm going to set 3x plus 18 equals 0. That means 3x is equal to negative 18, and x is equal to negative 6. Well, that is the value, that is the x-coordinate, or c, where our first derivative is equal to 0. Now, just to make sure that I haven't done something crazy here, I was looking for a c value, which is just the next value, that's between 0 and negative 9. Good. And, of course, this function is only going to be defined for values that are greater than or equal to negative 9. So you want to make sure that this answer that you get fits within that interval of a, b that we were looking for, and also make sure, of course, that it's within the domain of the actual original function. You know, maybe your textbook is going to throw some kind of really crazy, tricky problem in there, you know, seeing if you will check those answers when you are done. One more example. Before we get to the next example, I was erasing the board, and I thought if you went ahead and did that problem or wanted to do that problem with the product rule, you might want to see what the derivative process looks like. And when I got to my first derivative, I did not need to simplify that radical in the denominator and have it cancel with any x's in the numerator. So just to give you another look at finding the derivative of x times the square root of x plus 9. And hopefully by now that you're not still struggling with finding derivatives, but if you do have, you know, just as another reminder, if you have two terms in your function and those two terms have a common factor and the factor, you know, maybe has some negative exponents, or like we have rational exponents and negatives, one's negative 1/2, one's positive 1/2, make sure that you do try and factor out, well, you can factor out the lowest exponent, and that may even be the negative 1. Just a little tip there for you, make sure you don't make any careless mistakes in your work or help you understand maybe some more of your homework problems. And here now finally is our last example. Bam! Last example. Determine whether Rolle's theorem can be applied to the function f on a closed interval of a, b. If so, find all values of c in the open interval of a, b, such that the derivative of f of c is equal to 0. So our function here is f of x is equal to the cosecant of x. Our closed interval is pi over 2 to 5 pi over 2. And if you really know your trig functions, you'll know to just basically say, I can't apply the Rolle's theorem, explain and move on. But we're going to walk through a couple of steps just to, you know, refresh in some of your trig skills if you need it, and ultimately get to the point of why doesn't this work. Well, you know, here's our value of a and b, our low and upper limit of the closed interval. We're going to take the cosecant, try and find the cosecant of pi over 2. Well, If you don't know what that answer is, you might want to convert cosecant into sine, which you should remember off your unit circle. This is 1 over the sine of pi over 2, and the sine of pi over 2 is equal to 1. Remember your radians, this is 0 radians, this is pi over 4 radians, pi over 2 radians, or 90 degrees, and the ratio, the sine ratio is y over r. So your y value is 1, your radius is 1 in unit circle, and thus your answer is 1. Good. So now let's check 5 pi over 2. Cosecant of 5 pi over 2 is, again, 1 over the sine. I write a lot better not trying to do this backwards. There we go. The sine of 5 pi over 2, so that's 0 radians, pi over 2, 2 pi over 2, 3 pi over 2, their sine would be negative 1, 4 pi over 2, and then finally 5 pi over 2. So we're back up to that 90 degree, well, positive y-axis. So the sine of 5 pi over 2, again, is equal to 1. So f of a is equal to f of b. The function of pi over 2 is the same as 5 pi over 2. So why can't we apply the Rolle's theorem? Well, I just used the sine function to find answers for cosecant. That's because sine and cosecant are reciprocals, and their graphs are therefore very closely related. Your generic sine graph, the sine of 0 is 0, you go to pi over 2, you get a sine value of 1, then you go to pi, it comes back down to 0, 3 pi over 2, you're at negative 1, as I just, you know, indicated with my little hand motion there as I was going through the problem. At 2 pi, you're back to a value of 0, so this is the first period of sine, and then 1 half, 2 halves, 3 halves, 4 halves, 5 pi over 2, you're back to a value of 1. Well, there's our values of 1 that we found for the cosecant at pi over 2 and the cosecant of 5 pi over 2. But I'm not looking at the cosecant graph yet. I'm looking at the sine graph, which helps us, you know, guide our graph for cosecant. And everywhere that the sine function passes through its middle term, not the max and the min values, but the middle values, in this case those are the x-intercepts because there's no vertical shift, you get these vertical asymptotes. So this is actually the graph of cosecant and as you can see that cosecant function is not continuous on the closed interval from pi over 2 to 5 pi over 2, and that's why the Rolle's theorem cannot be applied even though f of a was equal to f of b. So even though I can find a place here at 3 pi over 2 where the derivative would be equal to 0, it's not the Rolle's theorem because we do not have a continuous function. So, I'm Mr. True. Go do your homework. Woo! Bam!